So there weren't very many people here who use CentOS, are there? How many people are there who use CentOS here? So, okay, that's a few more show of hands. How many people here know what CentOS is? Okay, it's a few more people, right. So apart from the four guys who use FreeBSD, and apparently all four of them are here today, I have a huge amount of respect for BSD. It's just unfortunate nobody uses it. How many people here actually do distribution engineering? I know there's a bunch of people here who work on upstream code, people who work on the kernel, people who work on development around, you know, upstream code. But how many people here actually work on distribution engineering? A few people. So what platforms do you guys work on? Okay. You won't hold that against you. Debian is, Debian is a different kind of a challenge. It's, okay. It's a case of how long we want to spend talking about this. The Debian world, which is pretty much, I would say, the backbone of the Linux world, has a very different paradigm, has a very different problem domain that they work on and they work against, and the ethics and the ethos that goes into Debian itself is very different from what goes into, you know, into CentOS. But is there anybody here who works on SUSE, maybe? Because SUSE and CentOS share quite a bit of ethics and ethos, as it were. Okay, not very many people, right, okay. That makes my life easier. So how many people here know about continuous integration? And how many of you guys practice the art of continuous integration? So, okay. So there are more people who do it than people who know about it. That's dangerous. I don't know what you guys are doing, but time to hit Wikipedia. So one of the key things about CentOS, one of the things that makes it very different from most open source projects, is that unlike most open source projects which are developer-led, which are feature-led, CentOS came up being problem-led. Back in 2003, lots of people were used to the Red Hat way of doing things. They were used to where configuration files end up in a Red Hat system. They were used to how, you know, the platform was implemented. They knew how RPM works, how, you know, they can expect some of the macros inside it. And Red Hat went away and created their RHEL brand, right, which is going to be the enterprise Linux stuff. And Fedora came up with a very short lifespan. And then there were people like us who were actually doing weird things to the platform, right? So I was running MySQL 3.23 in those days. It was a good release. And we were building it using the Intel compiler, and we were doing, you know, we had a real-time patch in-house at the time. And I was working in this beautiful industry called the direct mail industry, where, you know, we used to send a lot of profile, a lot of spam to a lot of people. But we had, you know, back in 2003, we had a 1,500-node big data warehouse cluster that was running off Red Hat 7.3. And we had a problem, right? We didn't have an upstream to go to. We weren't getting security updates anymore. And various people got together in various pockets around the world. One such pocket that came together was driven primarily at that time by the HPC communities. And they took the sources that were coming out of Red Hat on ftp.redhat.com and created, you know, they started building all of the packages into what ended up becoming CentOS Linux. Not a single person in that group was a developer. Like, if you got that group together and asked everybody, what do you guys do for a living? They were all operations people. They were all people who were sysadmins. They were all, some of the guys were CTOs and CEOs. But there was not a single guy in there who was a developer. And that mindset stayed with the project, you know, over the years, over the last 11 years, that kind of mindset, that kind of ethos that was built up during those early days kind of stayed with us. And we've tried really hard to be problem-driven. We always resist stuff. We always resist change for the sake of change. If somebody comes around and says, hey, you know, I can get your system deploying in, you know, it takes you 62 seconds, I can do it in 42 seconds. You know, it's like the typical response out of the CentOS community is, you know, that's fantastic, make sure you blog about it. But nobody really wants that patch. Nobody really wants it because, you know, it's like, you know, man, I don't really reboot my servers very often, right? If you can save me like 15 seconds of provisioning, you know, it's not that big a deal. If you do it in 6 seconds, I'd be interested, right? But again, it's a case of finding things which are problem-driven. And one of the things that we struggled with initially was that when stuff would break within the system, we didn't really have a bunch of people who could go and look at it. For example, if MySQL had a security update and an update came through, we had no way to evaluate that patch to make sure that what we're implementing is really going to work out there. So back in 2006, 2007, when the whole, you know, the DevOps, Agile stuff was coming through, CI was coming through as a big thing as well. And we really latched onto it within the project. All of us were operations guys, all of us were sysadmin guys. We saw this as an opportunity to build user expectation. I mean, our story was that, hey, you know, this stuff works. We would not release something that doesn't work. And we know it works because we ran these tests. We are confident in the capabilities of this code because this is what the test said it works. And if you don't believe us, here's the test, you go run them. And that worked out really well because we started with about 80 or 90 tests and we grew to about 7,500. I think by Christmas time 2008, we were looking at about 4,500 tests in the entire stack. And these tests were being run for every update many times a day. So what I'm going to actually try and do in the next sort of 15 minutes is give you guys a run through to what really happens within the CentOS environment. And a lot of you guys are looking at doing some really cool stuff. Some of the guys who are working on, you know, the networking stack and things like that, you guys should actually look at what we're doing and see how you can integrate. And we would love to host you guys in the environment as well. So I've kind of covered most of this. The key part of this was, you know, the bit at the end. We never released code that we wouldn't run in production ourselves. And I've got 2011 up there. How many people remember CentOS 6? Okay, a few guys. That's good. That's good. We really want people to forget about that. It took us 6.5 months to release CentOS 6 after Red Hat had released RHEL 6.0 because we couldn't get builds that were good enough for us to trust to deploy ourselves in our day jobs. So we held up that release. And what really helped during that time was it allowed us to bootstrap a community around the idea of continuous integration, that, you know, we should be constantly checking what code is coming in. We should constantly be checking to see what's coming next, make sure configurations are going to work, make sure status is going to be maintained, and things like that. So there are two basic key ingredients to a distribution, right? The first part of a distribution is that it's a collection of software. It's not the software itself. It's always a collection of software. And it's that collection that we release as the distribution, right? Individual software components should have their own testing. They should have their own environments. They should have their own unit tests. MySQL should be, you know, doing their own MySQL test. If a MySQL binary is sane or not, is a responsibility that MySQL should be taking on. It's not our responsibility. But making sure MySQL links to the right version of SSL, which links into the right version of Zlib, which links into the right version of, you know, the glibc stack behind it, is a distribution responsibility. And we have to be able to test both sides of that equation. So we have the native tests which run, which are specific to, a piece of software, like MySQL. And then we have the inherited tests, what we call, which we own, right? So we would never go away. Okay, sidebar. How many people here know about this company called Oracle? How many of you guys actually work for Oracle? Right. So you guys won't know, but Oracle sets a date for releasing MySQL. And whatever tests are not passing on that day are disabled, so that the entire test suite passes on the day MySQL is to be released. So that's one way of doing it. I'm guessing that's one of the guys who's doing CI who doesn't actually know what he's doing, right? So we inherited that kind of chain, right? And then it's our responsibility to find those tests which have been disabled and which are not running anymore. The second part of the equation, the thing that we really focus on, the thing that we really try and assert and, you know, aggressively stress, is the inherited tests. So this is the sanity, you know, checking for the collection, like I was saying, you know, making sure MySQL links against something that still builds, something that still can be used, making sure the ABI interface between libMySQL client and the libzlib hasn't changed, or if it has changed, make sure we assert that, make sure we, you know, kind of stress that to make sure it's still working. And then we validate the entire infrastructure around what we're delivering. So we validate the environment then the code was built in, like MySQL. We'll make sure that we retain those artifacts so that, you know, in 6 months' time or a year's time or 2 years' time, if somebody wants to go back and validate, hey, MySQL hasn't been updated in a year and a half, but everything else around MySQL has now been updated, how does that impact how the environment that MySQL was built in? You can now go and you can actually download the environment that MySQL was built in 2 years ago and then, you know, tweak changes and things like that. So if you want to own, for example, Ruby, if you want to own a specific JSON library for Ruby, you can go back into the distribution, find the environment Ruby was built in, change the component you care about, and then inherit everything else from downstream. So you don't then have to care about problems, bug fixes, security issues from that point on. You just care about the code that, you know, you're actually developing. And we do that across the board. So for every component in the distribution, that's about 8,500 pieces of software. So what I'm actually going to go into is the inherited testing. I'm guessing unit tests and acceptance tests are something that you guys are aware of anyway. And we've built the entire system of how we deliver CentOS around the idea of testing. So we've got our own build system that we wrote from scratch called Rimzu, which is effectively a Beanstalk worker and a whole bunch of Python scripts thrown around it. And then we've got a test suite. We've got the functional test suite, we've got the external test suite, and we've got the test suites, all of which are available on GitHub and Gitorius and on git.centos.org. So if you guys want to play, feel free to grab those. And then what we also do is that because we don't have any way of testing the kernel, we use the kernel.org's auto test suite. I'm guessing there's at least a few guys, the guys who are working on the low-level kernel stuff, who would know about the auto test suite, right? Is there anybody here who knows about the auto test suite? Okay, so I'm going to take a quick sidebar. It's every Linux kernel that gets built or gets any patch that gets accepted has to go through this limited CI setup that they have in place on kernel.org. And that's what's the auto test suite. It mostly stresses the interfaces between various components, like, for example, the block device interface into the VM or the memory interfaces and things like that. It doesn't actually test drivers, for example. It won't test file systems, but it'll test the interface between file systems and the rest of the kernel. And we run that sort of, 300 times a day every day against the distro kernel and the upstream kernels on the distro. The other thing that we also run is something called the Linux Test Project, which is curated primarily by the IBM guys out of China and India. And it's a set of about 48,000 tests which stress the environment for things like, get time of day being sane, things like your clock working the way it should do, things like, your file system being able to perform to a certain level, and things like that. And we run those tests many, many, many times a day. So let me just go into the build system a little bit, because this is interesting. And also, it was my fault. Most of it was my fault. Beanstalk was an easy thing to kind of bring up, so we kind of built the whole thing around it. And you've got the ability to have arbitrary hooks around various points, right? So you can have a hook in that says, every time a new PHP version is imported, notify me. And you can then make that call be either a blocking call or you can make it like a notification call. So you can say, every time a new PHP is imported into the build system to build, let me know. And until I say yes, don't move that forward. Don't go to build stage. And you can do things like that across the board, wherever you want. And that tends to be, that has a lot of utility. We'll get to that slightly down the thing. And then it can do dependencies across triggers. And it can do dependencies across the distribution. So you can do things like, every time there's a new OpenSSL build, also rebuild MySQL. And then you can also do things like, if a particular part of the code in MySQL is checked or tested or changed, then rebuild the kernel, or things like that. So you can have dependencies across the builds as well, across the sources as well. The other thing which it does, which is really cool, is that it can do like a git blame or a git bisect. So if Red Hat issues an update for, say, zlib, which doesn't build, what the build system can do is it can start unwinding patches within that RPM till such point it finds a place where things build. And then it can map those patches back in arbitrary order to find which patch is actually broken or which patch is actually causing the build to fail. This tends to be very interesting when you also include hooks into it. Because without going into details, we found at least half a dozen fairly severe security issues with Ruby in 2013 when Ruby would fail to build, and we would find points where we were able to find, so chunks of code which don't seem like they're related were kind of getting involved. I don't really want to go into too many details, but if anybody wants details, find me later, and I'm happy to show you guys how that whole thing works. And RIMSL works against anything which can do make sources. So it doesn't have to be a source RPM. It can be a Git repository. It can be a tarball. It can be whatever. As long as it's a make sources is going to work, RIMSL can consume that and can do all of its stuff on it. The other thing which is also very interesting is the fact that it's not backed by a database. It's backed by a full text engine. How many people here know, or how many of you guys actually use a full text engine? A few guys. So the big difference between a conventional database and a full text is that full text is based on text. It'll do things like, it'll give you proximity of words. It'll give you things like where stuff sounds like something else. When you do a like query, you can have wildcards on any side. You can do distance between terms and stuff, which works out really well, because now what we can do is we can find code that changed and map that back to tests that fail, which is more interesting to us than having like a SQL database. And the system that we use is written by a company called Thunderstone. It's called Texas, which is and it has like a SQL lookalike. So you can actually use SQL to say, hey, if this variable is causing me a bit of grief, where else does this figure in the entire distribution, which is about a 2.5 terabyte store. And it runs on a machine which has maybe 4 cores, about a couple of gigs of RAM, just SATA disks. And most of the time, we'll get like responses in 18 to 19 seconds. So it's really, really good. It's a fantastic engine. all of this stuff is going away because there's a system called Koji, which Red Hat curates, and is what is used to build Fedora and RHEL as well. And what we're trying to do is we're trying to now merge forward all of our changes into what is Koji so that, you know, it's more widely available. One thing I didn't mention is that the full text engine that we use, Texas, is not actually open source. We were at the time when we were building this back in 2009, we were given like a perpetual unlimited use license. The condition for which was that the interfaces into that would never be made open source, which is a bit of a problem for us. Which is why we're now trying to look at Omega and we're trying to look at, you know, Sphinx and things like that and trying to migrate our entire infrastructure over to Koji, which is completely open source. Right, so for the tests, we've got three different kind of test suites. The first is the T-functional one, which is effectively an integration test. So what we're doing is simple things like, can I ping a known host? Is Google still working? Can I still get to www.google.com? Can I still get to ipv6.google.com? And it scales to, you know, slightly further down, it becomes a bit more complex to things like, can I add a user? And then can I SSH in as that user? And then things like, you know, is IP tables sane on v4 and v6? Can I block outbound ports? Obviously, we can't test inbound ports because this runs on a single machine instance at this time. But it'll do things like it actually fires up a complete free IPA server instance, and it'll go through a complete regression suite to make sure that, you know, IPA is still working. And again, this whole test suite is available on the internet on git.centos. So please, if you guys want to play with it, feel free to do so. You know, that's the reason why it's there. And we also do role tests. So it'll do things like LampStack. It'll actually bring up you know, a MySQL instance with PHP and everything and make sure that entire stack is sane. And there's something like about 40 different role tests in there at the moment, and something to the tune of about 600 functional tests in there at the moment. And the stuff is typically, you know, fairly simple. So, you know, for example, this is one of the tests that happened in the free radius validation. And it's pretty simple. We throw in a database we already know has a Steve with a password CentOS, and we validate that it's still working. And regardless of what happens, or regardless of what updated, or regardless of what built, we will always run the entire test suite. And it takes, whatever, 15, 20 minutes or whatever, but we'll always run the entire test suite, which is important, right? When you're testing, you have to test everything just to find dependencies on stuff that is failing. So it's regardless of, you know, if you build, you know, whatever, MySQL, we'll still run the free radius test suite. I mean, the whole setup will run. The second stuff that we have is the external testing, where we actually validate stuff that people are using external to CentOS are still able to do what they're doing post an update, right? So the big thing in there is WordPress and Drupal. Both of those projects worked with us quite extensively. And what we do is we run through their quick start guides every time. So every time there's an update to anything in the system, we will validate that the WordPress quick start still gives you a functional website. We'll validate that Drupal is still installable and it still gives you a functional website. We do this for MariaDB now as of about 2 weeks ago. And we've been doing this for Mozilla Firefox since 2008 or 2009 or something. And there's something like about maybe 35 or 40 different external applications that we test for. So one of the things that you'll find as a theme in there, in all of the CentOS suites and the CentOS content, is that we're very heavily infrastructure driven. Most of the tests that we do are, you know, testing Postgres, MySQL, SSH, SSSD, free IPA, making sure you can authenticate in various ways and stuff like that. And that's not because we don't like the desktop. After all, 2014 was meant to be the year of Linux on the desktop, right? Just like 2013 and 2012 were. But it's just because infrastructure is what we know best. Infrastructure is what we have maximum amount of traction on. And we do have facilities, we do have, you know, potential to take on desktop tests as well. We just don't have very many. Right, so the last part of the test, which is my favorite test suite, is the T-Distro test suite. And this is what is run for the build release process. So this is the suite that is run every time we're going to do an update out to the user base. So we'll do things like making sure this updates version is actually newer than the last updates version. You know, it sounds like an obvious thing, but you'd be surprised when, you know, people have versions of the software called, you know, hey, this is my favorite project, -1.2.3.16.15.22.git.2014.0601.tar.gz. You know, it's not uncommon to find that, hey, somebody just did a release which is an older version, you know, evaluated numerically to the previous version that he had. And so we do things like that. So we check things like, you know, making sure the RPMs are fine, they're signed to the right key, making sure they are still sane. We'll do things like we'll unpack the binary RPMs and make sure that the sources inside those, things like texts, man pages, things like readme files, config files, actually map back to the source RPM that went in. So if somebody was to act funny, somebody was to break into the CentOS machines and try and influence a build, after the build has been completed, we'll find it there. And things like that. So we do a lot of the stuff in the distro stuff. Then one of the other things that we do is that for the Linux distribution, 99% of the content we ship is what Red Hat shipped as a part of RHEL, right? But we also change things. For example, we change RHEL trademarks. We change the Shadowman logo. In some cases, we disable Yum from hitting rhn.redhat.com because we want them to go to mirror.centos.org. And all of those validations in code happen at this stage. We don't do this in the defunctional bit. We do this here at the release stage to make sure that, you know, if you're putting out code, it's not going to go to bugzilla.redhat.com. It's going to go to bugs.centos.org and stuff. I think I have an example of a... So this is an example of a test that runs in the distro test suite. And, you know, I'm sure most of you guys have had multi-lib issues at one point or the other. And RPM has this concept of color where you can actually have two RPMs that correspond to the same package but represent different architectures. So, for example, you can have Firefox 32 and you can have Firefox 64-bit installed on the machine. And all that this does is it reports if the common content between the two packages has a different MD5 sum, because that will create a user issue at the end. Like, if you've got two man pages that have different content in them, that's a bad place to be. Right. So this is the kind of stuff that gets run in the distro stages. So how and where do we run all of this stuff? We have something called ci.dev.centos.org, which is where these test suites that we were talking about get run at least nightly. But they also get run every time there is going to be an update. They also get run every time somebody changes the test suite itself. So we're validating our confidence in the test suite by running it on a known good platform, and then every time the platform changes, we're running the test suite again to make sure the platform still does what it should be doing. But what we're really trying to enforce from the user perspective is that updates work. So what we do is we always start with a static origin. We always start with yesterday's build. We always start with the fact that, you know, hey, yesterday this platform was green, therefore we're going to apply today's updates and make sure that still works. And this is completely user-facing. So what we expect people to do, and what we know a lot of people do, people like Facebook do this as well, they actually track our Jenkins jobs on ci.dev.centos.org, and they only consume updates once the tests have passed on the ci.dev instances. Does that kind of make sense? So it's sort of like a continuous delivery without it really being a continuous delivery. People can choose not to just hit mirror.centos.org. They can choose to only consume content once it's been through the ci.dev setup. Which is actually three machines hosted by GoDaddy. And we're running OpenNebula there in that environment. Hopefully, you know, we might ship to OpenStack in the next couple of months. At the moment, it's running OpenNebula. The second thing that we have, the second part of the equation, the big puzzle, is the platform QA. Right, so right up in the beginning, when I was talking about testing the distro, we spoke about, you know, the inherited testing, things that we own, and things that the component guys own. So MariaDB should own MariaDB, Postgres should own Postgres. The Zlib upstream should own that, you know, the time upstream should own that. But we own the installer. We own the platform. We own the bits which actually get the software onto the target machine. And for that, we have something called a platform QA harness, where we've got a Blade Center, which is an IBM BCE. Does anybody remember when BCE was, let's say, end of life? I think it's about 8 years ago or something like that. But we got this. I got this off eBay. I think Vodafone was offloading a bunch of old Blade Centers, and I got it off eBay for I think £35 or something. And then I had to drive up to Manchester to pick it up, which probably cost me more. And then over a course of about 6 months, I bought, you know, $20, $30, $40 old IBM HS20s, HS21s, and things. And then, of course, inconveniently, this idea called hardware virtualization showed up. And none of our blades actually supported it, right? Because these were all like Pentium 3 and Pentium 4 based machines. But anyway, so this is what we've got. And what we do is we've written our own little, you know, piece of software, which we call the QA middleware, that talks to the management unit of the Blade Center from this other X3550 machine that we've got. And what we do is, this is hosted in Maidenhead, by the way. If anybody is driving by, feel free to say hi. At RapidSwitch. We do two machines out of these are only 32-bit capable. They're not 64-bit capable. So we use those for bare metal 32-bit installs. We do 64-bit bare metal. So we do, we're using the management unit. We can then provision, reprovision using PXE or whatever. We also have VMware in there. We have ESXi. We have KVM now, thanks to a couple of guys in Austria who donated to, I think it was HS22s. And we do VirtualBox as well. We use local and remote storage. There's local disks in the machine. We've got FCOE and iSCSI available, which is again from the blades itself. And we do the local distro media, and we do live media for the installs, and we run the whole thing either using PXE or using ISOs by using the memory management unit to map an ISO in. And the whole setup is the whole process is automated. We have about 100 kickstarts, and each of those 100 kickstarts gets run through every one of these combinations. So on a good day, on a sunny day, we could hit thousands of deploys. And how we validate the deploy it worked is that we log in on SSH. We do the teardown, we do the deploy, the machine gets installed. You know, so for example, the Zen machine, right? The Zen 64-bit machine, it'll get CentOS 5 on it, Zen will get deployed on it, we'll bring up like 5 VMs inside that. Then we physically log into the machines using Jenkins worker and run the entire T-functional suite. And if the T-functional suite passes, we know that the instance came up fine. So that'll include things like, hey, you know, it could ping Google, MariaDB was saying whatever, WordPress could come up and things like that. So we validate every install with that process on there. So on a bad day, we do about 500 installs, the stuff is failing, which is about 5 times the kickstarts. But typically, we do about 5,000 installs, you're consuming all updates for every day. So it's that Blade Center really does work for a living. I think out of respect for old age, we should really kind of think about expiring that soon. We also do instance validations with OpenStack and OpenNebula at the moment, which are, you know, we run like a 5-node OpenStack and a 5-node OpenNebula install. We're right now working with Amazon on the EC2 setup. We're doing Google Compute stuff. We've got Rackspace and SoftLayer in there. We've got I think 28 vendors that we do off-prem stuff with. And then there is, I think that number has gone up to about 72 vendors who work with us on hosting and VPS stuff. And just for the sake of naming and shaming, Bytemark is not in that list at the moment. And neither is DigitalOcean, because they won't consume our images, they want to build their own images, and neither is Linode. And hopefully we'll get all three of them in, because you know that's pretty much three of the biggest guys in there, right? Without them, there isn't much of a VPS story. It's probably important, I'm gonna take a minute here, just take a break and say that the reason why we do this, and the reason why one of the big wins we've been able to achieve with working with the people is, it took us 6.5 months to release CentOS 6, right, from the time RHEL 6 came out. It took us 14 days to get CentOS 7 out from the time RHEL 7 came out. But the other thing that also happened was because of the QA hardware that was in place, because of all of the testing infrastructure that was in place, on the first day, on the first 24 hours after CentOS 7 was released, we had 185,000 installs. Within the first 8 days, we crossed 1 million individual installs. 1 million IPs were running CentOS 7 within 8 days of us releasing CentOS 7. And that's a direct result of the fact that while we were doing the QA, all of these vendors, including Google, Google had an image on Google Compute with CentOS 7 8 minutes after we sent the announcement. Now, I'm sure they're good, but they were obviously keeping up. So they were tracking our QA cycles, and they were building their images and doing their own testing while we were doing our QA on our code. So when we went gold, they already had a 24-hour heads up to what code was going to be in there. And I think that was a great win, because you know, being able to do the announcement and then 8 days later hitting 1 million IPs was a fantastic win. And it's directly down to the fact that all of the stuff is visible, people could see stuff evolving. They didn't have to wait for, you know, a green light before they could go look at the code. It was all there. So in the immediate future, what we're trying to do, the next step that we really want to get to, I think I've got like 4 more minutes to I'll try and rush through this, because this is the most interesting part anyway. What we're trying to do is that I have always represented the user industry, right? As of about a year ago, I now work for Red Hat, so I get to work on CentOS full time. But I still think of myself as being a user, not so much of a developer. And I think what we really need to do, you know, the next paradigm that is coming through is the stuff that you guys are working on, right? New networking stacks, new containerization technologies, new, you know, storage technologies, the whole SDN stuff, software as a storage, the software-defined storage stuff, all of this stuff. This is the really cool stuff, right? But what everything needs is a platform to run on. Nobody really wants to go away and reinvent the platform. So you see this one school of thought where people say the platform is no longer relevant, you know, it's the application that is important. And I completely disagree. The reason why they say that is because they lack the ability to actually stabilize a platform. If you do have a stable platform, that gives you the ability to take away the bit that you care about and only own the bit that you care about without having to worry about the rest of the platform. And that's what we're trying to really get to. That's what my aim for, let's say, the next 12 months is to give everybody a platform that is tested, validated on Vagrant images, on Docker containers, inside EC2, inside Google Compute, inside 115 plus vendor ecosystems. As something that you can predict, something you can test against a single test harness, right? So now if you want to go away and you want to run yesterday's version of Ruby, or you know Node.js from like 5 minutes ago, or as Michael was saying, Kubernetes from like 16 seconds ago, the only thing that you have to worry about is the code that you care about, is the code that you're working on. Everything else along the platform is certified, right? And it's certified from a test suite that everybody else also contributes into. And that's really what we're really trying to get to, right? So a buy for and from the community. There are a couple of bootstrap projects that I'm talking to at the moment. And what we're trying to do with these guys is finding the value proposition as to what makes the most sense, right? How do we get a testing harness up so that the kernel patches that are going on LKML, we know that we can feed them back some karma. We can give a developer some sort of feedback that, hey, you know, this is going to work or this is not going to work. And again, it's back to the same thing. A lot of these projects are infrastructure driven. It's because we understand infrastructure. All of us come from infrastructure. If somebody here wants to do GIMP or somebody wants to work with, you know, Pigeon or something like that, please feel free to come forward. And, you know, I'm sure we can find something to work on over there. And these are all the projects we'll be working with at the moment to get the infrastructure up for them. Initially, we're going to start with nightly builds, ultimately moving on to tracking their CI infrastructure. And the other thing which is also quite interesting is that we have triggers that work across projects. So people like MariaDB will be able to rely on or have triggers based on kernel processes. The Atomic guys will be able to have a trigger on Docker itself. So if there's a change in Docker, that will trigger a complete CI run for Atomic as well. So it's not only within the distribution, which obviously they get, right? So they can rely on various components within the distribution, and distribution can rely on various components within the projects, but it also works amongst projects itself. So for example, if Ceph is coming on board, and Ceph wants to make sure that their code validates every time there's an OpenStack update or on a nightly basis, then they can actually consume our resources on CentOS to do that validation. Initially, we're going to do nightly and then moving to CI, okay, both ways. And unlike Debian, again, we don't care about licensing as much as Debian does. We also don't care about licensing as much as a lot of other open source projects do. What we need to make sure is that, A, the code is redistributable, and it is legal where it's being redistributed. You know, there are parts of the world where DVD CSS is actually legal. So for that purposes, we want legal to be legal in the UK and legal in the US. So as long as it meets that criteria, you can come on board and you can work with us. People like NVIDIA and ATI are actually doing that with us for non-open source code as well. And we're happy to consume that. We're happy to work with them on that. And then the other thing that we're also trying to hopefully do with this is something called repo outreach. I'm sure everybody who's used CentOS would know about this thing called RPM dependency hell, right? It's something that we've all suffered with for many, many years, and to some extent it's kind of gone away with, you know, Yum coming up, repositories coming up, but then all that's really happened behind the scenes is that the problem has switched away from the distribution to some of the repositories. Like Apple has something like, I believe, 3,500 packages in their EL5 repository, something like 1,800 of which are not maintained anymore, and something like 350 plus haven't had security updates. So what we're really trying to do is trying to bring them in, have a specification that we require them to meet, and set up a downstream repository that is then tested on a nightly basis or, you know, perhaps many times a day or whatever, just to make sure that the actual user experience can then be predicted, right? So you know that if something is available in Apple, it has been through a particular test cycle. And then hopefully expand that, you know, let every repository come on board. And we're hoping to do all of this stuff through something called ci.centos.org. We're dropping the dev bit. That was my idea. And how we're doing this is that we've got a cluster of 128 physical nodes. My talk today was actually meant to be a demo of that. But, it's like when you have kids, right? Kids arrive, and it's just unfortunate that the manuals that they've read and the manuals you've read don't really line up, because they're saying stuff and you're saying stuff. And we had a similar situation where there were different layers of people we had to work through. And it's just taken us a bit of time to kind of go through. But we've got 128 physical machines on there, including, and we split that between Intel and AMD, 768 cores. You don't actually get so many cores. We need to use some for management. And they're fairly well, they're fairly, fairly performant. It takes about 7 minutes to install one machine. But it also takes 7 minutes to install all 128 machines. And we're trying to work with the AMD guys to try and figure that out. The machines themselves are called Hufty and Pufty. Which is not my idea. And they're both C-micro boxes. Has anybody here worked with the C-micro box? No, okay, I'll just take half a second and kind of explain that a little bit. So it's a 10U machine with 4,000 watts of power capacity, It's got 64 nodes in each box, each of which is a physical machine. And it has what they call fabric, and I don't know what that really means. They have networking on fabric, which means you can get up to 40 to 60 gigabits per second on the network backplane. It does some level two features, but it's not really a layer two switch. It's not a switch at all. They just say it's a fabric. And you can run up to 4,000 VLANs inside it and stuff like that. And then they have a single block storage device, which can be as many SSDs as you want, which can be mapped in whatever way you want. So you can say, give me 8 of these SSDs as a single block device, map it to node number 14. And it takes between quarter of a second to half a second for things to align up. So you can do it fairly quickly. And the point there really being is that we're hoping to be able to run this thing in, on the whole cattle versus pets analogy, that the machines inside them aren't pets, the machines inside there are cattle. So basically provision, reprovision as fast and as hard as you can. We have done one test where we provisioned the entire set of 128 machines, and it took about 8.5 minutes to get there, which is pretty good, which I thought was pretty good. And this entire infrastructure is what we're going to be using for CI.dev, CI.centos.org. The process is going to be pretty simple. Open a ticket, clone a Git repository, merge request your Jenkins config file in, and off you go. It's basically as simple as that. I mean, the triggers at the bottom there are what we spoke about, that you can rely on new components in the distribution from Rimzul, or you can rely on community build stuff from CBS, or you can be like, every time I do a Git push on GitHub or whatever. So it's up to you to set up whatever triggers you want. The tech setup behind that is pretty much open for conversation right now. We've got a bunch of options we're looking at, and it's effectively tomorrow afternoon we're going to have the first public outing of the entire infrastructure. So what I would recommend is that everybody, or I would hope is somebody, joins the CentOS Devel mailing list and keep an eye out for the first announcement, and then feel free to kick in. Everything is up for discussion at the moment, including what CI infrastructure we're going to use. We have been talking to the Travis guys in Berlin. We've actually got a complete Travis implementation which we can run in-house based on their chef recipes. And they have a few challenges around bare metal. They can't really do bare metal stuff. We are very keen on having bare metal in there. There's an OpenStack group which is very keen on having Ironic, the OpenStack Ironic component, come in to their metal and to the VM side of things as well. We're also looking at, we're talking to AMD about having an arbitrated middleware for their IPMI interfaces so that we can just own our own stuff. The Jenkins guys and the JClouds guys are very keen on actually writing interfaces into Jenkins to manage all of this infrastructure directly from JClouds as well. So it's all kind of up in the air. Feel free to join in.